about the house, own your job, be encouraged, boo. Come on. A long way. That's why we love you. Come on.
Can't hang it now.
Oh yeah, I see.
Seed of a big dream. name that hasn't been born because
everybody wanna be rich and be famous.
It's rocking on a guitar.
But what is that?
That
ain't Georgia, it's still your land.
Where you at now?
Hey, mister, everybody can't always see what you can see. So let that go, move on to be what you wanna be. Explanation, you don't know it too, no, nobody. They think they can tear you down and kill your heart, no. Go get it, you got it, yes, you are a star in the man. Gonna be the one everyone looks up to in the dark. So what you thinking about? I can't hear you now.
Yeah,
I see of a big dream that hasn't been born because
everybody wanna be rich and be famous.
I'm rocking
on a guitar.
Yeah, yeah, sound big.
send up praise and glory to the one who is most deserving. Hallelujah.
King of glory, we send it to the kingdom of the earth.
Yeah. Praise
the
glory.
We bow down in reverence. You are the sovereign God we serve.
liberty. There is freedom where the Spirit of the Lord is. There is liberty. There is freedom where the Spirit of the Lord is. I declare it. There is liberty. There is freedom where the Spirit of the Lord is. There is liberty. There is freedom. Say, where the Spirit of the Lord is. There is liberty. There is freedom where
the Spirit of the Lord is.
There is liberty. Freedom where
the Spirit of the Lord is.
Who can satisfy my soul?
praise, just begin to speak well of the Father. He is holy. He is worthy. He is so precious to us. So, Father, this morning we join in heaven's song. We lift up holy hands without wrath or doubting. And we cry, holy. Holy you are. Father, you are worthy. Come on, somebody cry, worthy. Worthy is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. You are worthy to receive honor, blessing. All power belongs to you. You're worthy, worthy, worthy. You are so worthy. You were worried.
something rising in this room. There's a river, there's a tide, and I don't know if you can sense it or feel it, but there's something that wants to break loose. I'm gonna let this band minister to you, and you tell him how worthy he is. Oh yes, he is. You tell him how worthy, how good, how excellent is your name in all the earth, above the earth, beneath the earth. There is none like you. There is none that can compare. There is none that come close. There is none that can measure up against. But you are worthy. You're worthy on a good day. You're worthy on a bad day. You're worthy when it's cold outside. You're worthy when it's hot. You're worthy when I feel like it. You're worthy when I don't. With the money, you're worthy. When I'm broke, you're worthy. If I have heartache, you're worthy. In joy, you're worthy. In anguish, you're worthy. With tears, you're worthy. With a smile, you're worthy. With a frown, you're worthy. No, I wish I had a church that knew how worthy he is. Come on, pick up your cross and bear it. His word says in Matthew, he that does not bear his cross is not worthy of me. He didn't say it was gonna be light, but he's worthy. Yeah. Take you a moment. His name is Jesus. I'll bear it because you've been good. I said his name is Jesus. Worship the one. Worship the one. Yay! There is only one God. There is only one man. Between God and man, his name is Jesus Christ. Be exalted, O God. Be exalted, King of heaven. Yay! Oh, yes. If he's really worthy, you should praise him there. My praise tells the enemy, you should have came with something better than that. My praise tells the enemy, you should have got me before I got here. My praise tells the enemy, I am still breathing. I am still breathing. I got another chance. Ah, yeah. I got another chance. I got a second chance. A second chance at my manhood. A second chance at my womanhood. A second chance at my marriage. A second chance at life. A second chance. I got a second chance. Grace, mercy, grace, mercy. Praise him. You've made it. Hey, you've made it to a second chance. We gotta go. You made it to a second chance. You thought the first one was all you had. But this praise tells the devil, I will live to declare. I got some words to declare. I gotta reach one. I gotta bless one. Oh yes. I still got something to bring. I got some work. There's still a work over my life. Shut up, devil. That curse will not work. That plan will not work. That lie will not work. I have a work over my life. Praise him because he's not done with you yet. Woo! Oh, yes. He's not done with me yet. I'm still breathing. Real quick before you take your seat, wrap someone in your arms and said, I have a work over my life. Come on, tell them. I have a work over my life and I shall complete it. It shall complete. come to pass. Woo-wee! Worthy is his name. Worthy is his name. Worthy is his name. Something made you think he wasn't worthy. Some lie made you think he wasn't worthy, but worthy is. Some trial made you think that he would stop being God, but worthy is. And when I can't see my way, I can think my way into my next steps. Worthy. Worthy is. Worthy is. Woo. I feel him. We gotta move, but I'm about to give you just 10 seconds to let something just worship. I feel it here. Let these tears water what's next. God of covenants is in the room. Worthy. 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 That's it. You've been waiting all week to release this burden. That's it. That's it. Been waiting all week to get in this presence. That's it. It's carving this moment just for you. Reformation, you know the house rules. Just because we move on, if you're still negotiating and getting things right and making covenants and promises, you continue to do that and stay in that vein. If you have to run, you run. You got to scream, you scream. This is God's house. So, Father, we honor your presence. Lord, we don't take any of it lightly.
Father, in spite of ourselves and in spite of our week, in spite of everything that we've walked through to get in this place, we lay those things aside and we say, you are worthy. It's been tough, but you're worthy. Had to cry, but you are still worthy. Though you slay me, yet will I trust you. We believe that, Lord, you will do exactly what you said you will. If you believe that, put your hands together all over this building and give a worthy God some praise. Wow. Well, if the Holy Spirit has not done so already, those of you who are in this room and those of you who are watching us online, welcome to Reformation Memphis. We're so happy that you have taken a moment. There are many churches that you had to drive past to get here. There are many churches that you had to scroll past to get here. But we're so thankful, and we believe, as our apostle says, that God is going to leap right over that coffee table, right past that camera lens, and meet you exactly at the point of your need. So on behalf, again, of our pastors, Pastor Brandon and LC, we thank you so much for joining us here at Reformation Memphis. If you could, give your attentions to the screen as we have a brief announcement. God bless you.
Hey, everyone. It's LC, and this is your Reformation information. Resurrection Sunday is right around the corner, March 31st, and we want to encourage you to bring someone with you at 9 a.m. that Sunday morning. Listen, the scripture says that the shepherd left the 99 just to save the one. So we want to encourage you to bring one person with you. Listen, you can bring 10 if you want to, but we know you have at least one person that can use the word of God. So bring them with you on Resurrection Sunday. Next Sunday, we kick off Sunday School. This is happening March 17th. At 7 a.m. This is online only, so you don't have to worry about getting out of bed to make it into the building. So if you are hungry to dive into the Word and get a deeper understanding, join us Sunday morning at 7 a.m. for Sunday School. And I know you're excited that Midweek is back. We are bringing the Bridge to Bridge Sunday to Sunday. You come and get refilled with the Word of God every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We'll see you here. And ladies, this one is for you. Reform Her is coming May 17th and 18th. It's going to be two power-packed days where we're going to reform her. Her is you, her is me. We're reforming your identity, your intercession, your influence. So you want to be in the building May 17th and 18th and get everything that God has for you. Registration is open, so get your tickets, get your girlfriends, and meet us here. This has been your Reformation information. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Amen. Put your hands together for those announcements brought to you by our beautiful First Lady, Christabel Clack. If you haven't already, be sure that you go, all of the ladies, and register for Reform Her. I'm telling you, many other great speakers are going to be coming soon via social media. So you want to be sure that you get your tickets now to be in this place for Reform Her. One other quick announcement as we prepare for Resurrection Sunday. The dancers, the dance ministry is coming back. The dance ministry is coming back. And if you would like to be a part of that ministry, if you could, after service, meet Kayana in the back, and she will be sure to give you some information on how you can be a part of that dance ministry, because they are coming back on Resurrection Sunday. Somebody say Resurrection Sunday. Resurrection Sunday is this month, March the 31st, right here at 9 a.m., with the campaign of Just One. Now, it's important that we understand what Just One means. Just One is an opportunity for us to bring to God just one person that on this special Sunday, where we get to remember the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we have the opportunity to be His hands and feet in the earth. So say, reach one, bless one, bring one. Say, reach one, bless one, bring one. In the book of Matthew, it talks about Jesus is talking, and I believe he's giving a sermon on the Mount, and he talks about how when you have visited me when I am sick, when you have came to me when I was poor, when you had came to me in prison, he said, you have done these things as unto me because you've done it unto the least of these. And I believe for this Resurrection Sunday, the Lord wants to use us, use this church, to usher a people out of a season called was. To usher a people out of a season called was. You remember, many of you were in a season called was. I once was sick, but now I am whole. I once was blind, but now I can see. And how you do that and how that happened for many of you is because someone reached one, they blessed one, and they brought one. And so many times when you are evangelizing and God is sending you to go grab those and bring them into to the house, you can't just do it by saying, hey, come to my church, because there's a lot of churches in Memphis that are trying to get people to come to their church. The way you do that by bringing one, first you have to reach them. You have to reach them. Now, of course, that's wherever that looks like to you, whether that's your job, whether that's at the coffee shop, whether that's at the gym. You reach them, but just because you've reached them, you have not yet earned the right to bring them. You reach one, and the way you earn the right to bring them is to bless one. So that looks like one Monday morning, you bring your coworker some Starbucks, or you realize that someone has had a bad day, and you bring them some Zaxby's, or Zaxby, I'm telling you this, or Dixie Queen. I know y'all love, see, I didn't want about five people to Christ off of a Dixie Queen anointing. You have to reach one, but then do not forget to bless one. And blessing one often is going to require you to either go into your own pocket or, watch this, pull out of the abundance that God has given you so that you earn the right to bring one. When you bless them, then you have opened an entryway into their heart to tell them about this glorious gospel whose name is Jesus Christ. So repeat this, say, reach one, bless one, bring one. Amen. And thanks to all of you here for your contributions and everything that you continue to give to this ministry. Not only will God do exactly what he said he would, but Reformation is a house that will do exactly what we said we would. And we don't want you to just take our word for it. Please turn your attention to the screens.
What's going on, everybody? Pastor Brandon here. Please buckle your seatbelts. We are about to go on our first virtual tour. I'm going to do some vision casting for what I believe is going to be one of Memphis's staples for educational excellence and spiritual intensity. It's going to be called Reformation Academy. Reformation Academy is going to have 20 rooms, and the sizes of these rooms are going to vary from 11 by 12 to 11 by 15. Even to 11 by 20. And these rooms have specific purposes for educational excellence. There's even going to be a room where if your child needs some special attention, that almost like an intervention, there can be an opportunity for intimate growth from the educational perspective. And in addition to these intervention rooms, there'll even be a specific room that if your child is even struggling emotionally, there'll be a certified worker that will be able to assist that child to comprehend and to work through the different emotional challenges that they might be experiencing in that moment. We're going to reform the whole thing. All right, here we go. So in these rooms, the entire upstairs is going to be committed to elementary and middle school, okay? So it's going to be from K to 8, elementary to middle school. There's going to be a library upstairs. Fully working restrooms are going to be upstairs. There's a teacher planning room upstairs. Everybody loves a good teacher hangout in between classes. So they'll have a little place where they can have the honey buns and the little chocolate milk and where they can sway back and forth and ask God to come and help them for the next half of the day. Amen. All right, there's going to be a computer lab, which, you know, when I was growing up, that computer lab only had Oregon Trail. But in this lab, it's going to be a place where technology is going to be introduced at a safe space. Can I say that again? Technology will not be an open door for lust and corruption, not here. Technology here is going to be a safe space for us to be able to use some of these advantages to make sure that the student is getting every opportunity to grow. that's going to be in the technology lab. Look at your neighbor and say, technology lab. Not only is this going to be reformed upstairs, but there are going to be multiple exits that we're going to have to build out. If we were outside, you could see that there are some steps that lead to nowhere. But those steps now lead to somewhere. We're getting ready to open up a door. Now, I'm not preaching right here, but you know, sometimes God will just open up a door where there's nowhere. Reformation Academy, this is phase two of the upstairs. And as the coming months begin to unfold, we will show you the portables that are getting ready to be built on the outside of the building. But we wanted to start with showing you how our upstairs area is about to be turned from a dungeon into Reformation Academy. Reforming is all around us. You're getting ready to see it take place because of your willingness to generously partner with your seed in this local church as we reform the educational system one brick at a time. I'll see you soon.
Yeah. Yeah. Reformation Academy is coming with no doubt about it, and it's not just because we were able to do this on our own, but it's because you have given of your sacrifice, the sacrifice of which you work hard for, because you believe in this vision. Now, really quick, let me teach you how to receive vision. The way you receive vision is not just by getting excited or not just by picturing yourself in that thing, but whenever the Lord releases vision, you have to take it into prayer. Why? Because the scripture makes us to know that though the vision may tarry, your response is to wait for it. And I believe I'm speaking to some people, not only this church, but even in your personal life, where you feel like I'm somewhere in between the I saw it, but it hasn't quite happened yet. Somewhere in between I feel it, but I'm not quite there yet. Or somewhere in between it was prophesied, but my bank account doesn't show it yet. And right there is where you should start to feel a rumbling in your spirit, and something should start to turn over. As of a matter of fact, just lift your hands. Father, I pray over this body of believers. I pray over this aggregation that, Father, you have brought them into this house, not just for reformation in their lives, but, Father, even a reforming in their faith. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus that where the enemy has tried to make them feel that toiling and waiting was you not coming through on what you said you would. Father, I pray in this room that there would be an electric surge of faith. Faith, Father, that causes them to believe when they cannot see. Faith that causes them to walk when they don't see the door. Faith that causes them to build when all the money is not there. Now, God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that you are not a man that would lie, neither are you the son of man that will repent. But Father, your word makes us to know that if you said it, shall you not do it? And you will make it good. And God, I thank you that you are a God that makes good on your promise. Therefore, we do not have to be those that do not have a hope. But Father, our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and your righteousness. I thank you that we do not have to trust in a frame that cannot carry us, but you are the carrying God. You carried us through 2020 when we didn't know how we were going to make it. Yea, even make it as a church. You carried us, oh God, when we were locked in a room, given to our own thoughts. Yes, you even carried us through 2021 when things still were a little turbulent. And now, God, here we are on the precipice of what you're getting ready to do. And we will not allow the devil to talk us out of what you said. And although we're in the middle, we say, God, you have never given us a reason to not trust you in times past. So we ask for revival. Revive our trust. Revive our trust. Revive our faith. Revive our believability. Revive us. Revive us. Revive us. Because there is a vision, and we will not. Hey.
We will not squander vision because we've been lost in our own feelings, in our own motives. But Father, our trust is that you will do exactly what you said you would. Now, if you believe that, take 30 seconds. Hurry up and praise him. Hey! I said, praise him. I said, praise him. I don't see it, but I know how to praise. I don't feel it, but I know how to praise. Yeah. Now, right there, many of you in this room through prayer have worked up enough faith to believe him again. Through prayer, many of you have worked up enough dexterity to keep going again. Now, here's the key to the vision of God. Although right now you feel like you have faith that whatever the Lord showed you when you were 20, whatever the Lord showed you about your business last month, right now you feel faith come alive that you will see that thing. But what happens when the bill knocks on your door on Wednesday? Do you return back to the place of a lack of faith? Because, Father, how can you say and I don't see? No. Here's what you do. You pray again. Watch this. You don't only pray, but you intercede again. Intercession is standing in between the gap, until what I see starts to come a little bit closer. Key word is a little, which meaning that if the vision tarries, I'll keep waiting in anxious prayer that, Lord, I know you're gonna do exactly what you said you would. Now, here's my challenge. My challenge to you is, for many of you in here, you don't have what you need to make the vision come on your own. If you did, I would question if your vision was really from God. If you had everything you need to make it on your own, what do you need God for? And I've learned that in the moments that I don't have everything I need to give everything that I have. Therefore, if it doesn't meet my need, it must be a seed. If it doesn't make what I see my reality, then that means I need some sort of supernatural activity to come and help me do what I can't do in my own strength. Therefore, as a result, not only do I intercede in prayer, but I partner with something that's bigger than me. Now, I'm not trying in no way, shape, form, or fashion to tell you to do something that I haven't done my own self. Me and my wife, we were in Chicago when we were completing our fix and flip project. And in the middle of our fix and flip project, I lost my job. Smack dab in the middle. Now, not only am I a husband that is having to grapple with the provision of my family, but I'm also a husband that's having to grapple with thousands of dollars that isn't going to the roof that's over me and my wife's head. It's going to something that I feel like the Lord told me to do. Now, here I am. Around this time, Pastor Clack, I believe it with 100% of myself, Pastor Clack was sent to Chicago, not just for that moment, but for the one I'm standing in now. He was sent to Chicago, and he challenged us in sowing. And I told my wife, I said, now, I don't know. I said, I feel like I'm supposed to, but I just can't feel that this is actually going to do it. I mustered up enough faith. I gave, and I gave big in the middle of this transition period where the house, you're not quite there yet, but I'm still sending my wife to work, and me, I'm trying to do everything I can. Baby, you ain't got to come home and wash these clothes. These clothes is washed. This food is cooked. I'm just trying to be a good husband. You working, you come home. I just rub these feet. Until I saw, I gave. By this time, we were expecting for the house was up to be sold, and
It seemed like weeks and months were going by. I kept giving. This last time I said, all right, God, now either you gonna be God or I'm gonna have to figure something else out. I said, Lord, I don't have another option but to trust you. I gave of our last. And there'd often be times that, you know, I went home. I have a real nice iPad. I said, babe, you know, I'm gonna just put this iPad on Facebook Market. I don't need it no more, just so that we can just get a little bit of something. Honey, put it on Facebook, didn't nobody buy it. Said, ain't that I sold on Sunday. By the time Wednesday had gotten here, my realtor called and he said, it may be a long shot, but I think we got somebody. And by this point I said, just give it away. I don't even want to look at the house. But it wasn't, catch this, God didn't do it because I was hurting. God did it because I trusted him. That let me know that just because I hurt, my hurt is not enough to move him. And Father, when I hurt, I not only give you my hurt in intercession, but I give you my natural that won't work for me right now. I know many of us had given already in first fruits. First fruits for all of us is still extended until Easter. Whatever that looks like for you, however that sounds like for you, the Lord has given this house, and not only this house, but he's given you a vision. And if I be God's man, I can promise you not just by what I've practiced in my life, but because sowing and reaping is what is in God's word. This is good ground. You sow into this, I promise you there will be a testimony. I can't tell you how that testimony is going to come. For some of you, it may come in that business. For others of you, it may come in, I was sick, but now I'm well. Others of you, it may come by saying, man, my marriage just turned around. But that's because what your hurt couldn't do, God's hand can. With that thought, we're going to give. We're going to give. See the giving prompts on the screen. If you're giving via text, that's 1-888-364-GIVE. You still need more time to gather your first fruits. Like I said, we're giving until Resurrection Sunday, March the 31st. But this is an opportunity for us to partner not just with this vision, but partner with what God has shown you. Partner with what God has already given you. And you're just waiting in between to see what God has said. If you're giving, stand. And as you're standing, I just want you to lift that phone, lift that envelope. If you need one of those, our attendants are in the aisle. Just wave at them if you need one of those. This seed, I'm not giving out of my abundance. I'm giving out of faith. Yes. Faith is hard when I can't see. But Father, my trust does not go by what I see. My trust goes by what you said. You've never let us down before. So Father, we lift these gifts to you. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you are God that sees our strides. You see our efforts. And Lord, we thank you that there's nothing that happens in our life that catches you by surprise. Lord, as of a matter of fact, your word makes us to know that you predestined and ordained everything that happens in our lives. And so, Father, even in this moment, some of us are giving out of abundance. Some of us are giving out of sacrifice. And even some of us are giving out of faith. But, Father, we give not because we know that it's going to happen tomorrow. But, Lord, we give in hurt. Many of us, we may give in pain. Many of us may give in asking, Father, what is next? But Lord, you've never been one to let us down. So Father, here we are trusting you again. here we are believing in you again. Take this as an offering. Take this as a seed, and we give our seed an assignment. Let it go into our future to create avenues and streams of wealth, Lord, where we will not only live off of what we make, but Father, we call in overflow. We call in increase. We call in healing. We call in deliverance. We call in your presence. We call in your spirit. Let it come as a result of us trusting you one more time. And Lord, we give you great praise and glory in Jesus' name. Come from all over. If you have your phone, just come and tap here. Just come and tap here. I'm tapping in faith. I'm giving in faith. I'm believing in faith. It may be tough, but I'm trusting you again. It could be rough, but I'm trusting you again. Your trust, my trust is built on you. Nothing more, nothing less. Our trust is built on you.
Pastor Khalil, Leah, where are y'all at with that house? Did it end out favorably? You could just scream out yay or nay.
Nay.
Nay, okay.
It's sold,
but you need some money back. Okay, lift your hands. You don't have to stand. Lord, I'm asking for a favor. I'm asking for a favor. Can you update that man's testimony? I'm grateful for how he left off with it. But can you do something in their lives that eyes have not seen? Do something that will make family members scratch their head in disbelief. If you need a house or some place to live, lift your hands. I'm asking that the blessing over this church would be houses that they did not build, vineyards that they did not plant. May your people come into occupancy of things that credit scores said they don't deserve. And I promise you, they won't be stingy with gratitude, and they won't be stingy with their love on you. We give you praise for it. Just take 10 seconds and just worship your God. I don't know how, I don't know when. Oh, but I got a good feeling. Something is turning in your direction. I've been on the road of discomfort long enough. I'm getting ready to exit this mess and sit right down in a miracle. Something is turning in my direction. Cried long enough. In fear long enough. I am preparing for the greatest celebration of my life. Get ready. The doubt is coming down. This will be marvelous in his eyes. The handiwork of the Savior. This will be marvelous. I'm coming into something marvelous. Like it or not, honey, my season just changed. These are not flowery words without power. I'm standing on sacrifice and thanking Him for a whole new season. And we give the Lord praise. Be seated. some kind of way, Pastor Khalil. You watch and see. If God's favor will not smile on you for the moves you've made in faith to forsake your home to build His, will I, the Lord God, not come and prove myself? Are not generations of tubs on the line? That if I say yes to my son, who else will trust in me? May the beginning stages of a patriotic grace come upon you. And may your children's children remember that Grandpa Khalil trusted God when it was easier to tuck tail and run. May the men out of your own seed be reminded of how to treat a woman when she's working to support a family, instead of finding accusation of why my hands can't build. In Jesus' name. One more time, clap those hands and give the Lord a great praise, everybody. I'm sitting down this morning on purpose. I honestly feel like, and hear my heart, I feel like I have nothing to prove. And I'm not interested in performing the traditional Sunday nostalgic feeling. What I'm really concerned about is obeying God. And the Lord told me, Pastor Debbie, this year, make sure my people know why they believe what they believe. And some topics require a different posture so that you can hear a different level of content and tone. And this will be no different. And so you'll see sets like these and moments like this. And when you do, you'll know that it's a conversation that is best fitting for this type of posture rather than the traditional one that we will use quite often, all right? So Pastor Javan and I are going to dive into Genesis chapter 13, amen. And for the content, Fred, that we're going to talk about, I think it was best befitting that I sit down and talk about it through conversation and questions, because the title of today's conversation is A Divine Breakup, amen. And I thought this would be better fitting for a Valentine's Day message. And it just so happens that in October, when we were planning out preaching the whole Bible, God knew this Sunday was already earmarked for Genesis 13. Isn't that amazing how God works? He can speak something to you in October and know when it's supposed to happen in March. Amen? All right, Pastor Javan, take it away.
Do me a favor. If you love Jesus, just look at somebody and say, Jesus loves you. And so do I. Amen. If you are sensitive to what God is doing, I believe God is preparing our palate for our conversation today. Last week, our apostle did an excellent job talking about faith in famine. He talked about Abram's faith, lack of faith in leaving the place God brought him, going down to Egypt. It was there that he lied to Pharaoh and told Pharaoh that Sarai was his sister instead of his wife. We learned that God dealt with Pharaoh, and then Pharaoh rebukes Abram and kicks him out of Egypt. And Pastor, even as the Lord was ministering this morning, I feel like somebody in here is about to get kicked out of last season. Because you've been there too long and it's unprofitable to the covenant God made with you. And so God is so committed to his covenant with Abram that he ministered in a way to Pharaoh. Pharaoh rebukes Abram. Abram leaves and goes back to the place where he built the altar, which brings us to Genesis chapter 13. And we're going to start reading at verse number 1 from the English Standard Version. It says, so Abram went up from Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him into the Negev. Now Abram was very rich in livestock, silver, and in gold. And he journeyed on from the Negev as far as Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning. between Bethel and Ai to the place where he had made an altar at the first. Say at the first. And there Abram called upon the name of the Lord. I want to ask Pastor a question right here. Can you explain the significance of Abram leaving Egypt in light of his story up to this point?
Yeah, make sure you get something to take notes with. Don't just try to absorb it all, but make sure you write down what God's going to say to us. I think it's important that we understand and notice and really agree that Egypt is not God's intended place for Abram to develop trust. He's only in Egypt because famine broke out in the promise of God, which is Canaan. And there was an unexpected problem in God's promise. Now, that's not a problem for God. And because God has no problems, if there is something in the promise that doesn't match the expectation of God's word, then it must be a test for you and I. And Abram decides to leave God's best version for his life. He goes to Egypt, and I'm grateful that in spite of all of the confusion, misunderstanding, that Abram has the courage to leave where he is to be where God told him to be. And right there, just write that down. I've got to have the courage to leave where I am to be where God called me to be. I've got to have the courage to leave where I am to be where God called me to be. For many of you, it will be leaving an emotional opportunity. For many of you, might mean a relationship. It might mean so many things it can mean. And you'll know in your heart, because if you are planted in anything that God has not called you to be at some point, it will not work for you. So we have spent in well-intended intentions, Donnie, we have cast down the devil, we have fought sicknesses, we have told God to heal and deliver, and I wonder if the discomfort you are in is because of disobedience. Because if it is, then there is no prayer that can rescue you out of God changing his mind so that your disobedience now fits his plan. So God will allow discomfort. Just elbow somebody and say, I'm uncomfortable. God will allow discomfort if you're putting your trust in places and people that it should not be. And then the other thing that is important for us to understand is that Abram is going to go back to the beginning where his first altar was. Right there. You know, you don't even need much expounding on that because that almost preaches itself. He goes back to the beginning. And I think that is really the amen of God over this year here at Reformation, as we are going back to the beginning and the basics of what God has called us to be. Please hear me. Going back to the beginning does not suggest that you have to start over in accomplishments. Okay, so I need you to grasp that. Just because I'm starting over doesn't mean I'm starting from scratch. So please be willing, whatever it looks like, to go back to what God originally called you to. You cannot exhaust obedience. You have to live in obedience. And because we are governed by graduation dates and anniversaries and birth dates, we live with promotion in mind. We live to become the next blank. But when you obey God, you should settle in to the pleasure it gives God when you say yes. Can I tell you something? If what you see in front of you now was the totality of God's assignment for my life, and he says nothing else, then I am content with what is in front of me now. Because I would rather fall in love with consistent obedience than to let ambition make me disobey God because I want more. Amen.
All right. Lay your hand on your chest and say, Lord, help me to obey the first instruction. Verse number 5 says, and Lot, who went with Abram, also had flocks, herds, and tents, so that the land could not support both of them dwelling together. For their possessions were so great, they could not dwell together. And there was strife. Say strife. Strife. Say it with your chest. Say strife. There was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. At the time, the Canaanites and the Perizzites were dwelling in the land. Pastor, you've been pastoring for a long time now. You've been in church since Christ died, just like many of us. I'm sure you've had to deal with strife in your own life and even strife as a believer. Can you tell us from your perspective, what is strife? And then part B to that question, can strife hinder a season?
Yeah, that's a great question. I want to start off with strife from a perspective of wealth. And I know that's going to sound a bit contradictory and a bit clashing, but I want everyone in this room to notice that the Bible says that Abram left Egypt and he was very rich. And this is the part right now, and I get it, where there's going to be tension in the heart of the believer, because there is this idea that God can only bless you and God can only use you if you don't have any money. And I want to be very clear with my statements, because I know what era we live in. I want to be very clear with what I'm saying. I don't believe that we come to Jesus for materialistic gain. I don't believe that it is God's guarantee that if you come to him, you will be rich. I think there will be some people that will live for God and die and only make $40,000 or $30,000 a year. And they'll love God and they'll get their eternal reward. And I think God is okay with that. But I want to balance that statement that I also believe that if you come into millions upon millions of dollars in the morning, that it is not a sign of rebellion or sin that you had to do anything anti-God to receive it. Not only is God not going to be against you, but the Lord can give you a strategy on how to disperse that wealth so not only others can be abundantly blessed, but so that your family for generations can still benefit off of the amount of money that you were given. I am not preaching to you the prosperity gospel, because I don't believe in that. But I will not tell you that God can only use you if you're in poverty. I want to be very, very clear. This is before the law that Abram was rich. And I'm going to make it a little worse, Fred. He was rich, if you pay attention to the text, not because he was serving God. Now, don't say amen too hard, because I don't want you saying, ha, I knew it, down to the corner. No. Okay. He did not get rich serving God. But when he repents and goes back to his original altar, we don't see God saying, yeah, I'm going to need up all of them riches and cows, and I'm going to need all that back, burn it in the fire, and offer it on the sacrifice. We have no proof in the text that God is going to curse him for the way he received those riches, even when he was outside of the presence of the Lord. This is not my green light to you to make money and disobey God. The only principle I'm trying to give to you is that you can love God and make money at the same time. All right. So hopefully that's a broad enough explanation. Because I'm going to be honest. Some people are excited about not having money and they want to be a financial martyr and they don't want to do anything of increase because that keeps them close to God. And you know what? I'm not mad at you. That's just not my story. Amen. I don't have to be an alcoholic. I don't have to be a weed head. And I don't need extra women on the side in order for me to have money. I can have money and love one woman and love Jesus and take care of Noah's grandchildren, die and go to heaven, and high five Paul and say, so happy I made it over. Okay, amen. Don't elbow nobody. Just shake hands with yourself and say, it's okay to make money. Okay, amen. Don't elbow anybody. So I think that there is a position of strife that you and I have oftentimes in comparison to money. And I want you to just make it if you want it. And if you don't want it, then just love Jesus in whatever state you think is best for you. Amen. But the gospel is not centered around materialistic gain. But the Bible is clear about strife. Now watch what happens with strife. The Bible says, hallelujah, not only did Abram have money, but he had so much money that Lot got some money too. I don't want to tell you how to pick your friends, but amen. Lot said, I know I wasn't supposed to go, but if sticking with you gets me paid like this, I'm following you wherever you go. Look at your neighbor and say, choose your friends wisely. Y'all just sharing buckets of popcorn. Amen. Choose your friends wisely. Hallelujah. And don't just pick them for monetary gain. Hallelujah. All right. But we see the strife because the promised land that God has for Abram is specifically designed by God to support who he spoke to. So to take anybody to a good place that is God's plan, and they're not invited to it, will ultimately end in strife for you. I want to say that again real slow. I expect you not to take notes on this one, because this is where you're going to clutch your pearls a little bit. Because wanting God's blessing, if God says something to you for you to do and you to go, if God tells you to pack your bags tonight and move to New Orleans, and you tell your best friend, this is what God said. And if God said it, this sounds like a good idea. You better hear me. What God said to you may not be a blessing to them. This is where the tension in the text is beginning to rise, because we don't like the thought that God will do something that looks good for me and not invite you into it. And I don't have answers for why he won't include you in the best version of his plans for my life. I don't know why God will include the person on the 9th row, but not tell the person on the 4th row that they can come. And because I'm not God, I've decided not to fight with him over what he decided. But Abram decides, I'm going to invite somebody into the plan of God that God did not invite. And this is where strife breaks out. The Bible is clear about strife. Everybody say strife. Strife. Yeah, the Bible's clear about strife. Strife is an image that is synonymous with intense mental conflict. That is strife. Strife is synonymous with intense mental conflict. Please hear me. In the Bible, wherever there is sin, strife will follow. Write that down. Wherever there is sin, strife will follow. You can find that in Galatians chapter 5, verse 20. You can find that in selfish ambition. The Bible warns us. Everybody scream warning. Warning. This is the Bible. This is not Brandon Clack's opinion. I want to be very clear. This is the Bible. The Bible says, for anybody that is more committed to dissension, strife, gossip, and tearing down vision of a place. Your Bible says, not Brandon Clack, your Bible says that you should at all costs avoid them. Not hear them out, not hear their perspective, not try to be unbiased, not try to make sure that you let both parties. The Bible says, look at your neighbor and say, the Bible is right. And somebody is wrong. Thank you, Bishop. I hear you in my ear. The Bible is right. Somebody is wrong, and the Bible said anybody committed to continued strife should be avoided. My question for you, it's rhetorical. You don't have to respond out loud unless you don't want to. Why do you entertain something that you know is tearing down someone else? Have you ever stopped to address what it is in you that enjoys hearing the tea? It don't even taste good. What have you asked yourself? Why am I so intrigued about the latest drama circling and surrounding the church, my cubicle, my what is it about us that is desperate to continue strife? You want to know how you continue strife? Entertaining it. When you sit through an anger conversation and you turn your ears into a trash can, you begin to house waste. And the Bible said that Lot is in a place that he was not invited by God, but he just saw God on someone else. And the herdsmen start to have strife. Watch what happens, because strife can definitely hinder a season. But God, give us some Abrams that can confidently come to the conclusion, here it is, it's best that we part ways. I want to talk to all the people that are called to something full of destiny, full of forward movements, full of the plan and purpose of God. And I want to prophesy to you right now, and I just pray you receive it. You don't even have to lift your hands. I prophesy to you that before you will be whatever God said, you're going to have to break up with something. The Lord said to my heart, many of you are carrying too much. I don't know if it's people. I don't know if it's memories. If there is the right smell, many of you will go right into old group chats that you've had for years that you should have deleted. And you will rekindle relationships that God has not ordained you to carry to the next. Did you hear what I said? At some point, you're going to need a divine breakup. Can I just encourage all the people that are afraid to break up right now? And I'm not telling you to, listen, don't you have nobody looking for me talking about my pastor said, we done, and then now 40 people looking for me. Lord, send your angels to protect your humble servant. Many of you are afraid of godly breakups because you don't like someone saying they're in a downward spiral because of you. If you obeying God, it is quiet in here. If you obeying God send someone into the threat of a downward spiral, my friend, you were never supposed to be in that relationship to begin with. If you are the object of stability in a relational context, my friend, you need to reroute that individual back to the Lord Jesus Christ. But we don't at times because we love feeling needed. We love being the place where you can pat someone on the back and they say, feel so much better after talking to you. You want to know what that does? That makes us feel good when we are absent of personal accomplishments. So strife breaks out because Lot is in a place that God didn't call him. And the land can't support the kind of wealth God gave Abram and the kind of person that Lot is. Strife breaks out, and it is unavoidable because what you refuse to leave behind will create strife if you take it to your next. What you refuse to, write this one down. What you refuse to leave behind will cause strife in your beautiful next. And there's nothing more exhausting than trying to enjoy a godly season and having to fight with one that shouldn't have came with you. Lay your hands on your heart and say, do not let them go. Do not let them go. Do not let them go.
Do not let them go. Make it a song so you won't forget. Do not let them go. Do not let them go. Do not let them go.
Look at your neighbor and just sing it to him one time. Hurry up real quick. This is going on the second album. This is how we're going to start the second Reformation album. I'm going to come right on and say, do not let them go. We're going to get a Stella off of that. And award winning, do not. Ooh-wee. Okay, next question, third question. Let me move on with that one. Do not
let them go.
All right. We're going to start every service from now on. Do not
come on, sopranos.
Do not let them go. I couldn't resist. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Okay. Find your parts. Okay, go ahead.
Pastor, as you was talking, it came to me that I think sometimes we wrestle with the sovereignty of God because we want to decide who comes with us out of a fear of being alone. We don't want to be the pioneer. We don't want to be the pioneer in obeying God when I don't have a blueprint, obeying God when I'm by myself. And so it's almost like we tell God, Lord, you don't know what you're telling me to do, because I need somebody to come with me. I need a companion to help me do what you told me to do. And so I think in the sovereignty
look
of
at
God,
somebody and say, you don't need what you think you need.
You don't.
No, for real, look at somebody, because they need the courage, because somebody about to leap right away. You don't need what you think you need. You don't need.
Second track, amen. Tev, give me E flat. Hallelujah. Okay. In God's sovereignty, we have to come to the resolve, Pastor, that God is in charge. You saw the movie Hustle and Flow. God is in charge. God does what he wants, when he wants. He chooses who he wants. And if that means taking you from where you are, putting you in a city you do not know, around a people you do not know, God is sovereign. And I think we have to put your hand on your heart and say, Lord, I accept your sovereign plan for my life. Verse number 8 says, then Abram said to Lot, let there be no strife between you and me, and between your herdsmen and my herdsmen, for we are kinsmen. For we are kinsmen. Is not the whole land before you? Separate yourself from me. If you take the left hand, then I will go to the right. Or if you take the right hand, then I will go to the left. Verse 10 says, and Lot lifted up his eyes and saw that the Jordan Valley was well watered everywhere, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, in the direction of Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Verse 11 says, so Lot chose for himself all the Jordan Valley, and Lot journeyed east. Say east, that's important. Thus, they separated from each other. Pastor, I got a question. Are separations godly?
So we see strife is possible because of, at times, keeping what God says to leave behind.
Yeah.
It will ultimately end in strife. Separations are godly, but don't just look at it in the negative connotation. God is separate from his creation. Isaiah 40 and 22. Is he who sits above the circle of the earth, above, not in, above the circle of the earth. And his inhabitants are like grasshoppers. The inhabitants of the earth are like grasshoppers. God is, the prophet Isaiah is giving us a contrast. This is how we are. This is how God is. So God is separate. Not only is God separate, but God's people are supposed to be separate. Psalm 135 and 4, for the Lord has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel as his own possession. There is a commitment you must make to having separation from evil people. Key word, evil. Just because you have a disagreement with someone doesn't make them evil. Amen. But evil people. 1 Corinthians 15 and 33. Do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. Can I just, I feel like I'm already at reform her, and I'm going to do a reform him too, because I'm sick of the men getting left out. I'm done with that. But since the women are up first, amen, just calm down, fellas. Don't get mad at me. Can I tell you that if you don't develop you, you won't be able to change anybody. The Apostle Paul telling a wife, everybody say a wife. I want to be clear. The Apostle Paul told a wife to stay with her unbelieving husband and her conduct would change him. That is only for a wife. There is no other relational aspect other than witchcraft that is going to make somebody be anything. So if you are, and men as well, you can't change nobody. If you don't assess that bad morals will ruin what God is doing in you, you'll start taking on assignments that will ruin your character. Have you ever, I shouldn't even ask this. Have you ever had the relationship where you were just so attracted to the individual, you knew they were wrong for you, but you said, I could change him. I could change her. If I just had some time with her, if I just had some time with him, I would change. And before you knew it, you were participating in stuff that you said you were assigned to change. So separation is godly. But what I love about the confines of this text is that we're going to find that Abram says, hey, Lot, let's just go our separate ways. I don't want anything from you. I don't want you to return anything you've received by being in connection with me. But clearly, number one, you weren't supposed to be here anyways. Number two, so much strife has broken out. Here's where my heart broke. Strife is breaking out. Read the text. And the Canaanites and the Perizzites are in the land, which means they are watching God's selected people have a civil war in between them. And there was nothing worse than God's people fighting in front of those we are supposed to be influencing. But because we love our disagreements, so if your motive for confronting disagreement is only to piggyback the momentum of discouragement and frustration, and you have missed the point of confronting your brother and sister. So Abram tells him, look, let's have no strife between us because we're kinsmen. You go your way, I go mine. Notice the fineness of the text. The Bible says Lot lifts up his eyes and he sees the well-watered plains that are going to ultimately lead to Sodom and Gomorrah. The Bible gives us clear inclination that that city has wicked people in it. But because it's well watered and it looks good, Lot looks with the eyes of the flesh and he follows what looks best. Then we come to Abram, and Abram, God's gonna say to him, now you lift your eyes. You survey the length and the breadth of this land, and I will give you as far as you can see. Did you notice the distinction? The distinction is Lot looked with the eyes of the flesh and followed what was appealing to carnality. Abram looks with the eyes when God says to look up, and he can have what God says he can have. Every godly separation, keyword godly, will end in the Lord telling you to lift your eyes. When you separate from whatever it is that is distracting you from the goodness of the Lord, your next command will come from him. Lift your eyes. I will show you that what you are living without cannot compare
to what you're about to walk into. Many of you are about to be confronted with the instructions of the Lord, me or it. Here is the challenge. Abram has to believe what God shows him is good, even though it only looks like dirt and sand. But I would rather trust the nothingness of God than to have in my hands the riches of sin. Lot goes his way, Abram goes his way, and he notices here that God's going to give him, and you can read the rest of the text. I'm done. You're going to notice here that God is going to show Abram just the extension of the Abrahamic covenant he's already made with him. It's almost like God's going to beef it up and put it on steroids. And then at the conclusion of walking the length and the breadth, and noticing the stars and noticing the sand and noticing the expansion of what I'm going to do for you, notice that God does not make this promise to him until he separates. And there are many of you waiting on instructions for what life is supposed to be next, but you won't separate from lust, and you won't separate from anger, and you won't separate from theft, and you won't separate from violence, and you won't separate from lying. Whatever it is in you, let's stop focusing on people. Let's talk about you. Amen. Whatever it is in you that you need to disconnect from, because you know what I think, Dimitri? I honestly think that today's topic is not about the lots in our lives as if we're Abram. I think we're Abram and Lot. I think that we vacillate between being pagan and patriarch. I think we vacillate between trusting God and touching stuff that we shouldn't. I think we vacillate between being independently exclusive for the presence of the Lord and then going into cities. And cities is only a mindset. I'm not talking about actual cities. But then going into cities where there is controversy and alternate ways and alternate gods. I think we're both. And until you're ready to be honest about the lots in your life, you're never going to be Abram. There is a confrontation that's warring out in your soul right now. But here's what I love, and I'm done. Your Bible says that it suggests that Lot had already pitched his tent towards Sodom, which means he was already drawn to it because he's not the one that had the covenant. Your Bible says that after Lot picks up and goes his way peacefully. Lift your hands. I prophesy peaceful separation to you. I prophesy that the things that you're about to disconnect from, that it will not end in extended war, not mental war online, not physical war of confrontation. Peaceful, peaceful, peaceful. What I love about this story is that in the separation, watch what God does. The Bible says Abram takes his tent and moves it immediately. Did you hear what I said? Whatever direction Lot is going in, Abram says, I'm going to pick up my stuff and go the opposite way. Because oftentimes following God is opposite of following your flesh. He picked up his stuff. He turned. It's almost like a type of sanctification where I am being separated, set apart for the particular use of God's plan in my life. I am separated, set apart for a particular use of God's plan in my life. I am separated, set apart for a particular use of God's plan in my life. I am separated. I am set apart for a particular use of God's plan in my life. I am separated. I am set apart for a particular use of God's plan in my life. I'm not better than you. I'm just separate. I'm not higher than you. I'm just separate. He just earmarked me. He just set me aside. I have just been before the Lord wanting and almost eagerly desiring, Lord, give me something else to preach. And the Lord said, Clack, shut up. I have separated you. I have set you apart for a particular plan, for the purpose that I have for your life. He turned his tent. He went another direction. And in doing so, your Bible says he built an altar. He built an altar. He already visited an altar from his beginning, but it's not enough to have one altar from your beginning point. Every time God reveals himself to you, you need an altar.
He builds an altar, but he builds an altar by an oak tree. Now that doesn't mean anything to you because it's not Good Friday yet. But I know another altar that was built by a tree. It was a place where a sacrifice could be offered. It was a place where the blood of the lamb could be moved. It was a place where there could be reconciliation between God and man. It was not an altar made of stone. It was an altar made of wood. It was a mean, biting, cruel altar. It was an altar with spikes, 6 inches, if you will, that was exuding out of this tree. It was not a sanded down cross that we wear as emblems on our chest, but it was an instrument of destruction to the flesh and Jesus Christ. Your Bible says the Apostle Paul, I'm standing. Your Bible says that the Apostle Paul is going to tell us that these tents that we live in, they are corroding. But there is another tent that we are going to get. It's called the heavenly body. And I want to see now in the text that Abram is giving us a foreshadow of Christ Jesus. That as he turns his tent towards an altar and a tree, so it will be that that tree that Christ dies on and his tent, his body, will be turned towards the heavenly expansion of the kingdom of God. And so it is. Here you go. So it is that humanity is crumbling under the fear of sin, that lost men and women find themselves trying to come to their own conclusions of building a life for themselves, only to find the gratification of the flesh. For the flesh can be so gratified that we not know that we are sinking in desperate despair, as if it were the quicksands of sin grappling us. As we try to rake our way out, it pulls us further down. I don't know if you've ever been lost in sin and so blind to the comedy and the relief of the jokes of Satan that you didn't even know you were in trouble. I don't know if you've ever been so lost in sin that you wished that somebody would incorporate you in an evangelistic journey, because at some point, once sin loses its laugh, it becomes like a curse, promising me that there is no consequence for my sin, only to lead me down desperation and despair, that when I realize I'm wrong, it makes me feel like shame is my only closet. But I have good gospel news for you, that Christ Jesus stands as our advocate. He stands as the one with palms dripping with blood. He stands as the one who is the only remedy for a mind that is drunken in deception. He stands as the one that decided to swap places with you and I so that you and I could be considered co-heirs with Christ Jesus as our elder brother makes way for us. Can I pray for you? My God, I thank you so much for the opportunity to minister to your people. And many of them, my God, are on the precipice of a divine breakup. And I thank you, my Father, that we are breaking up with the sin nature. For we will not arrogantly turn this breakup towards a person. The Apostle Paul told us, Father, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. And so, Lord, we give you praise right now that the you you're calling us to be, we are coming to the forefront because of a divine breakup. I thank you, my Father, that on the back end of separation, we are about to get a clarion call to lift up our eyes and see what you have promised. For the promised vision is for a set time, and that time is waiting on the sons of God to come into covenant alignment. For you, my God, are not interested in only but paying off the sinner. But I thank you, my God, that you will lead us with loving kindness, that we might follow the truth of the gospel to see why you have called us into this glorious light. I thank you, Father, that in the next few minutes, there will be many under the sound of my voice that will make an inner vow of the things they will never go back to again. I thank you, my God, that under the sound of my voice, that many preachers and pastors
pastors and prophets and apostles and evangelists are coming into the covenant requirements that they will not vacillate between the flesh and your favor. I give you praise, my Father, that coming to church is not just about an emotional thrill ride, but coming to church is so that we can be confronted with the us that needs to change. Thank you for an old church that would say, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. This morning I intercede as an under shepherd for your people, that we would come into covenant responsibility, that we would come out of the blame game, that we would come out of finger pointing. My God, can I pray for the universal church? My God, can you touch your bride? For she is starting to major in civil war, and she is starting to be more confident in our distinctions and disagreements than we are about good doctrine. And I pray right now, my Father, that something supernatural would break out in your church. I thank you, my Father, that the bride's complexion would begin to turn into holiness. And I'm asking now, my God, that peace would be over your body. And we aren't necessarily looking to point the finger in criticism, but we are crying mercy, mercy, mercy. For the Canaanites and the Perizzites are mocking. The Perizzites and the Canaanites are mocking as there is civil war breaking out amongst kinsmen. But my God, I am asking that the peace that passes all understanding, let this blessed confidence come upon your people, that if we yet but trust in you, that we will have peaceful reconciliation. Do me one favor, grab your neighbor's hand real quick. I know you need me to pray for you, but I feel like praying for the bride. And I thank you, my God, that pastors all over America, I intercede for them. For we are in the time frame where the critics get paid to have their accusations. But I'm praying, my God, for every pastor that will stand in pulpit. And my God, can you cover their mind? Can you renew in them the joy of their salvation? I wish you would help me pray for pastors. My God, from New York to Boston, from Los Angeles down to New Orleans, back up to North Dakota, and back down to Corpus Christi. Can the crisscrossing of this nation find pastors that are committed to the gospel of Jesus Christ? My God, let us come out of bickering and out of complaining and out of our inward fighting. But my God, this morning, we are praying. We are crying, squeeze that hand. I'm praying, God, for pastors all across the nation. I'm asking God that the truth of the Bible, the God of the Bible, the power of the Holy Ghost, the truth of our doctrine, I'm praying, my God, that the gospel would be preached with confidence. Let it be preached with courage. And we extend the blood of the Lamb, the blood of the Lamb. Let your blood cover pastors. Let your blood cover prophets. Let your blood cover apostles. Squeeze that hand. Last round. And we give you glory, my Father, that they had, although the criticisms are at an all-time high, don't let those men and women of God hurt themselves because of mental warfare. Hey, glory. I'm praying, my God, hey, that all attempts to just end the assignment early would be broken, broken, broken. For many don't understand the mental turmoil that comes with leading your people. But I'm praying, now, my God, that these men and women of God all across America would find themselves. We respond as first responders. Put my picture up. We respond as first responders. We are responders, intercessory responders, that when car accidents take place, hey, I feel impartation, that when car accidents take place on the freeway, make us like a Pastor Bernice. Hey, 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 like a midwife. I heard you, Holy Ghost, when her husband put that post up and he said, Bernice, rush to that car accident and applied pressure where the young man was bleeding out. And the ambulance said he should die, but he will live because you responded. Make this church a Pastor Bernice, that she would respond to the lacerations, to the scrapes, to the wounds, to the bullet holes, to the pains of ministers and ministries. This is a church of first responders. Hey, 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 hey. For the Lord told me, Tevin, that the waters of intercession had increased because there were accidents in the spirit. He said, but Brandon Clack, if you'll stand in the gap, I will use this place to rush to those that are bleeding out. Thank God for Pastor Bernice. She is a prophetic sign of a first responder. Lift your hands. I prophesy to your house. Everybody in your house, may the spirit of first responders. Hey, hey, hey. May your mother, hey, glory. Touch Levi. I heard you, Holy Ghost. I, the Lord God, will visit Levi. I, the Lord God, will visit Levi because of a praying son. I heard the Lord say, Donnie, watch and see. If the hand of the Lord does not come upon your father and rescue him from despair, I prophesy to everything breathing. You are in the house of first responders, that when accidents break out, the moving of the waters will rush in. May every brokenness, every pain, every despair that is upon your life, may the power of an intercessing Jesus at the right hand of the Father, forever making intercession, you won't bleed out. Did you hear what I said? You won't bleed out. Hold still. Let me put the pressure of the word of God on your wound. You won't bleed out. Look at me. Keep breathing. Keep talking to me. Keep, stay with me. Don't you doze off. You won't bleed out. Look at me. Keep talking to me. Look me in the eyes. Stay with me. You won't bleed out. Can you touch three people and say, don't bleed out. Don't bleed out. You ain't touch nobody. I said, touch three people. Don't bleed out. Don't bleed out. I know you're in pain. I know you're bleeding. Don't bleed out. Don't bleed out. The first responder is here. The paramedics are on the way. But until they get here, God sent me with a word. Hold still and let me put this pressure on your wound. I know the pressure hurts, but if I don't apply pressure, you'll bleed out. You've been hurt too bad. Hold still and let me put this pressure on you. Turn the other cheek. Pressure. Forgive your daddy. Pressure. Say no to lust. Pressure. Come to prayer. Pressure. Let me put this pressure on you. You are in a season where the wounds are real. And if you don't let me put some pressure, I gotta get out of here. Look at your neighbor and say, hey neighbor, he's right. The wounds are real. The pain is real. I have the lacerations. I have the bleeding. Now ask me how I'm still standing. You ain't talking to nobody. I said, ask your neighbor, how are you still standing? Still breathing. The man of God put pressure on my wounds long enough for the Holy Ghost to sew me back up.
I'm done. Bring her to me. I need some oil. Is Elder James here? I'm done. Take my ring off, son. It's okay. You are more necessary than you ever have been in your life. I read that post as your husband celebrated you. He was right. What God has put in you is enough to keep lives alive. There will be many marriages that will come to the two of you and find new hope and new joy. Lord, I thank you for the years that you have anointed this man of God. I thank you for the well done that's over his life. And in this new season of retirement, I thank you, my Father, that he is coming into even greater purpose. For I see the Lord bringing new passions out of your heart. Passions that will mean something to you. The Lord says, son, have no fear of what the coming days will look like. Have no fear of having nothing to do. I, the Lord God, will visit you. And I will speak concepts and promises to you. And you'll treat them and assume that they're just good business ideas. But the Lord said, I visited him. I anointed. Father, thank you for this first responder. I lay my hands on her. She is a template for what this church is becoming. And I thank you, Father, for the lives she saves with her natural hands and the ones she saves in the spirit. For the Lord said, many have their sanity because of your prayers. I'm watching you, Pastor Bernice, slipping out of the bed and walking the floors in the middle of the night, praying that family members' minds would not lose them. And you had wondered, Lord, it doesn't look like it's getting any better. The Lord says, not only is it getting better, but I was creating in you another level of empathy and compassion. For you will come across, many will be the sons and daughters out of this womb. For the Lord says you are not only assigned to natural family members, but there will be many women that are beneath your age that will begin the term mom and dad. And the Lord said, don't shrink back for it. I know that your motives are pure. The Lord said, don't shrink back from it. What you'll do is you'll be walking them through discipleship so that they avoid pitfalls. The Lord says, well done. I have used you as a template for this church. Lift your hands, church. I gotta go. Gotta go. Father, we trust you. Come here. We trust what you're doing. Father, I come in agreement with this family. I come in agreement with your plan for them. I thank you that no good thing will you withhold from them. To them that stand upright. And I'm thanking you, Father, for the things that they want to let go of, but it doesn't want to let go of them. And I think I'm listening to a conversation. I'm trying to let it go. I'm trying every time, but it just helps me when I have anxiety. Hey, glory. But I heard the Lord say, daughter, have no fear. From this day forward, I, the Lord God, will begin to work on your taste buds. And I, the Lord God, will begin to reconfigure in you the desires that I want you to have. For the Lord says, have compassion on each other. Don't be too harsh with your words. There is a becoming that is happening in this great union, and you will see that the hand of God is coming on you, not just in an internal perspective, but I even sense that God is rushing to some aid for you. For you had wondered, Lord, if you were so good, why don't we have the particular resources so that we don't have to get outside of your presence to provide? And the Lord says, fear not, daughter, for I am the Lord God that provideth for thee. Only but trust and believe by the pace of my word that I will lead you into the proper decisions, and there will be a collision course of the right relationships that will come upon you. And I, the Lord God, will bring you relief. And I come against all doubt that would try. I wish I had a praying church, y'all watching. And I just come against all doubt that would try to make you feel like this moment was not real. May the grace of God be so extended to you that you would come into the full knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lift your hands, church. Lord, we give you praise for the things that you will do. And I thank you that all accidents, whether in the natural or the spirit, will not come to fatal endings. We cancel casualties. We cancel casualties. We give you praise. Can you clap those hands and give the Lord praise, everybody? Come on. We're going to go. Everybody standing. We're going. Hallelujah. No casualties. You will get from destination to destination safely. You will arrive from destination to destination safely, in the natural and in the spirit. You will arrive safely. You will arrive safely. It's what God was telling Abram. You will arrive safely, safe and secure in the hand and plan of God. Only but have confidence in his word, only but trust his statutes, you will arrive safely. You will arrive on time. You are not behind schedule. You are in the timing of God. You are in the plan of God. And although transitions quickly shift when you're comfortable, you are still in the timing of God. I want to encourage you with that right now, in Jesus' name. All right? Here's what I want to do. I want to challenge everybody. Grab a $25 offering if you have that. Get as close to it as you can. Let's sow. I don't want to tamper with this moment too much with a whole lot of words. You're watching online. Get your offering together. Thank you, Father. We trust you. We trust you. We trust you. Anybody that was in a terrible car accident within the last 10 years, wave at me. Lift your hands. Terrible car accident. If you weren't supposed to walk out of it, raise your other hand. Can you, if your hand is up, can you just step in the aisle? Don't come to the front. Just step in the aisle. 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 Hey, step in the aisle. Glory to God. Church, while you're getting your offering, can you turn and face whatever aisle is closest to you? Turn and face whatever aisle, if you're in the middle, just pick one. Turn and face whatever aisle is closest to you. Stretch your hands towards these survivors. Glory. Because these people are standing in this aisle today, they stand as a prophetic promise that no matter what, that no matter what collision you get into, your life will not be a casualty. These men and women standing in this aisle, we pray for you now. I don't care how long ago the accident was, if you are still owed something, whether it be financial or physical, I am asking God that before the summer gets here, that he would go retro, back into that accident, and that he would retrieve for you everything you left behind. Lift your hands. I declare for the people in the aisle that even if you got the maximum, I'm asking that God would send you overflow, recompense. Today is the day where the casualties, today is the day where the casualties did not win. And we commemorate this day. I build an altar. I build an altar around your accident. And I prophesy, this is the day that the death angel tried to snatch you. And this is the day that we celebrate. There is no casualty. There is no casualty. There is no casualty. We commemorate this day in the spirit that the devil tried to steal you. Wow! But this is the day that the casualties got canceled. And we give the Lord praise. Yes, we do. Call the pallbearers and tell them the funeral is canceled. Come and bring your offering. Come on, come touch the front. It's holy ground up here. Come on. Get an offering in your hand. Hurry up. Come touch this front. God bless you. I'll see you Sunday. No, I'll see you Wednesday.
Wednesday night for the bridge. This is the Sunday that we remind the devil the casualty is canceled. Hey, hey, hey. I prophesy to you, Sierra, this will be the foundation of your testimony, where you will tell men and women that the casualty got canceled. It claimed the life of others, but when that death angel tried to come get her, it had to back up and go the opposite direction. God bless you. You are dismissed. We'll see you Wednesday night. Hey, hey, hey. The casualty is canceled. The casualty is canceled. I almost had a breakdown. Almost lost my mind. God canceled the casualty. God bless you. You are dismissed. We'll see you Wednesday night. Oh, what a glorious time it will be. Hallelujah to God.